Zalapski coming up with it. Lost it! He's right on the score!
Weeks ago, I'm in Moscow. Yeah. I'm in Moscow doing something for the Jackson Center. And it was on the 60th anniversary of the commencement of the Nuremberg trials, and they were having an event.
Yeah.
And I'm traveling through Moscow with a translator.
Yeah.
And he asks me where I'm from.
Yeah.
And I told him I'm from Buffalo, New York, and he threw up his hands.
Yeah.
And he goes, oh, the scandal. What scandal? And he goes, Alexander Mogilny. And I said, oh, you have no idea. The guy in the middle of all that is part of the law firm I'm a part of. Bob Swados. And he goes, oh, the scandal, the scandal. So it's a perfect segue.
Yeah.
Tell me about the Mogilny story.
Well, word got around through the gossip that Alexander Mogilny, who was considered the most talented player in the Russian Federation, was talking about leaving. The money in the NHL was, you know, much more than anything he'd get out of being a Russian player. And sure enough, we get word from Phil Esposito, who was then the general manager of the New York Rangers. He calls, I don't remember who he made the call to. It may have been Don Luce. He calls Don Luce and says, you know, there's this player, Mogilny, or whatever his name is, seems quite talented, and he called me, or his agent called me, and, you know, if you guys are not really interested, we'd be glad to take him on. So, word comes around the office, there's a big confab. I think it was Luce and somebody else at the moment, I'm sorry I could check that up, he wants to defect. They get the word he wants to defect. So they go, I think it was to London, and they finally make contact with his agent, who couldn't speak English at all. Mm-hmm. And Alexander at that point couldn't speak English either. So they managed somehow to get him into the United States. So at that point, they come to the council. What are we going to do? We got to find some way to keep him here. Already the Soviets had heard that he'd left. Mm-hmm. They proceeded to trash his house, his mother's house, to fire her from her job at, I think it was a large retail store, and announced that he was a traitor, and in effect, they were out to get him. So the question came to me, how do we keep him here? The Russians had walked right into our trap by trashing her, by firing her, his mother, by announcing that he was a traitor. Mm-hmm. So, after a search of the immigration laws, we came up with the idea he could be a refugee, and we'd have to find some way to have him qualified as a refugee normally a refugee is somebody that's been under surveillance for a long time and has the reputation like Solzhenitsyn or somebody like that, you know, of being a great independent individual entitled to be treated in the U.S. laws.
McGillney trying to get free at center. McGillney in over the Montreal line, and the backhand score! Oh! Oh, my! Alexander McGillney, who says this guy is afraid to fly? He left a vapor trail!
We had more trouble with the local immigration people than we had with the Assistant Secretary of State. But finally, after about a month of negotiations and conversations and trip to Washington and everything else, they finally agreed, yes, we will qualify him as a refugee under the Refugee Act, and therefore he's entitled to remain in the United States as a permanent resident, which was very helpful up to a point. So the next question came, what do we do when we play in Canada? So I called various people. I had been involved in the negotiation of the Canada-U.S. tax treaty, the most recent one. So I had some contacts. Yeah, don't worry about Bob. We won't let him get him. So that wasn't sufficient. So I called the lawyers in Montreal who had represented the Canadian for some time. I said, listen, when this guy comes over, I want him to be watched. I want you to make sure that wherever he goes, there's somebody available in case they try to pull anything, because, you know, this is Stalin-esque tactics going on here. So fortunately, they didn't make a move at that point. But about 2 weeks later, I get a call from the NHL, at that time it would have been John Ziegler's office, I guess. That was 1989. So whoever was on the phone said, Bob, one of the Russians has been in here, one of their lawyers, and they want to talk to you, and we think you should talk to them. So I said, well, I'll talk to him, but we're not going to let this guy go. We're not going to let this kid go. He's highly talented. He's entitled to be at the top levels of the business, and we're just going to let him go. So I go to New York and go into the NHL office, and there's a guy sitting there with a long beard. He looks like a combination of Stalin and my father. But he didn't behave like my father. He actually threatened me. He said, you have stolen this player, you have kidnapped him, you're violating international law, and what else? He said, at the end I said, I'm sorry. Under our system, this kid is entitled to carry out his life and his career here, and we're not going to let him go. That was the end of it. So I expected that I'd get some kind of a lawsuit or something, but ultimately nothing happened. So Alexander came onto our team, and in the year that he was paired with Pat LaFontaine, he had 76 goals.
Yeah.
Which was I think it was tied for the number of goals that year, and one of the highest in the history of the league. He was very talented, and that year it was one of the most exciting years in the history of the Sabres individually.
Way to center ice. Here's LaFontaine to McGillney. He's got a break. McGillney shoots. Richter makes the save. He's
So when we boarded the plane in Buffalo, Norty Knox says to me, Bob, when you get to Russia, don't get off the plane. If you're in the boat, don't get off the boat. He says the Russians don't like you. I'm not sure.
On the opening faceoff, number 18, rookie Danny Gare, quickly made his presence felt as he scored his first NHL goal only 18 seconds into his first NHL game.
Slaps it off the boards in to Don Lewis, centers the throw, rams it, goal post, the rebound is scored! Danny Gare on the rebound.
Sidestep. One of the most popular singers of all time.
Met girls, yeah. It's interesting to say that because we used to frequent a place called Mulligan's out in Buffalo on Hurdle Avenue, and always a nice place to go after a win, and enjoyed it very much, and had a few pops now and then. And actually, Derek's wife, Trixie, as we call her, Diane, worked there, and Derek married her, and so did Terry's wife. So it happened to be a place of, you know, getting together. And unfortunately, my wife didn't work there, and she's no longer my wife. But anyway, maybe that was the clue. But no, I used to give tickets away when, you know, I'd had a couple drinks to pretty girls. And what would happen is they would end up standing up at the ticket box office, and I'd only be allowed at home, you only got two tickets. So I'd be grabbing, asking older guys for tickets here, tickets there, which was a no-no. And then finally Punch Imlach came up to Larry Carrier, who also kind of took care of us single guys, and said, what's this crap with Gare going on? He's got all these girls up here looking for tickets, and I'm tired of giving away all these tickets to Gare's girlfriends. And he said, well, it was tickets here, tickets there. So that's how. That and one other story that I'll add to it is that I first came to Vancouver. If I make the pros, first game in Vancouver, you can all come. I'll take care of the tickets. 8 busloads came. It cost me $4,382. Dave Schultz was, his nickname was the Hammer, and he was the leading penalty minute player, I think, in the last 3 or 4 years, and they had the quote-unquote Broad Street Bullies. So here I am, a little kid from Western Canada coming in, and they had just won the cup the year before. 18,000 screaming idiots in Philadelphia, and as they always were. And Kate Smith had just sang, and it was like, wow, this is, you know, so I got to do something. So I go down, the first shift goes, puck goes into their end. So I run Schultz as hard as I can, and the crowd goes, whoa, you hear him. So puck comes back out, they get control and moves back out into our zone. And I knew he was coming after. I could smell his breath on my back. And I went left real quickly, and he went right like a fool into the boards. And it was like, whoa, this isn't good. And the crowd doubly going, whoa. So who's this little guy? So we come up in the middle of the ice, and we had a bench clearing. He jumped me, and the bench is cleared. Like, they jumped, and it was like, benches were cleared where guys were fighting, scrambling. Everybody was, Dudley was fighting, Shoney. So I could get through it. I got through my fight with him. But the best was after it was over, it was like, he's going to the penalty box. Hey, you little fart. He goes, who are you? New tough guy for the Sabres? I said, yeah, you big goof. You got a problem with that? So actually, it went on and on and on. It went all the way to the Stanley Cup Finals. I fought him about 5 times that year, and it was back and forth. Hey, you little shit, you know. Yeah, you big idiot, you know. Never really could fathom how bad it would be until the game, you know, got going, and then it was just, you couldn't see. And I remember these guys used to come out with sheets, and they thought that if they, and they couldn't even skate, these guys. They were like the rink rats. And, like, they were trying to go around. Half of them were tripping over these sheets because if they thought the sheets would be, like, a filter that would maybe cut the fog. I don't know what the idea was, but it was very comical. And we would skate around every, whatever, it's 2 minutes, and so would the Flyers to try to, because it would eventually try to lift some of the fog and the density of it up. And then we ended up, they kept playing the game, which they had to, and We had the infamous bat that was hit, and then also Rene scoring in overtime. So it turned out all right. The
auditorium crowd produced an enveloping blanket of fog, which eerily lay on the ice.
Off the boards in the corner, Robert going after it. He scores!
Came down to the last game of the season when Richard had 49 and I had 47, and it was against the Leafs, a team that we all hated. It was at home in the odd, and I just never really thought about 50 goals. I mean, you're 47 until I think it was Freddie Stanfield, the veteran, said, "You know what, Danny, you may never get this close again." You know, so I go line up against Sittler, Lanny McDonald, and on my side was the wonderful Tiger Williams, who was one of the toughest guys in the league and played against him in junior. And he says, "You're not even going to get a sniff, Gare, tonight." And he starts swearing at me or something. And I says, it just got me mad. It got me real mad. So I played, and Rico went at it. The first period, nothing happened. I think we were up 1-0. But then I got one in the second period. And it was now 48. Rico had 49. So now I'm getting power play time in the third period because people wanted both of us to score. And I got 49 on a deflection from one of Richard's shots, which went over the top shelf into the net. So we're both tied. And then the last one I scored with about 10 minutes to go in the game and got 50, which was amazing. And I got the 50-goal puck in my hand. I said, "Hey, Tiger, you wimp, you little pussy, that's 50. And I flipped the puck, and he started screaming.
The 50-goal mark for a third consecutive season. The Leafs keyed on Martin, preventing him from achieving that goal. But in doing so, allowed Danny Gare, a longer shot at the 50-goal mark, to score a hat trick.
Stanfield in front to Martin. He shoots right on the credits in the score.
And I tell this story about Gilbert, which is funny, because my very first year, my father would always send me letters and say, "Danny," he says, "the area you got to improve upon now," he says, "now that you're in the league, is in order to beat defensemen, you have to learn moves. Like you have to deke left and go right or left or go the opposite way." And I said, "Yeah, but, you know," he says, I said, "how am I going to learn that?" He goes, "Well, talk to Joe Perreault. He's the best at it. Get him after practice someday." So this is my first couple months in the league, and I'm like, "I'm going to ask Gilles Perreault about deking. I mean, you know, I feel like I should ask for his autograph." Like I said earlier, I'm not even ready for it. So finally, around February, I'd had a few goals, and I asked Gilbert after practice. I said, "Gilbert, excuse me, would you mind maybe helping me, you know, on deking or how you can make your moves? Would you mind spending a few minutes after practice?" This is after, or then spend some time with me after practice. He goes, in his French accents, "Danny, I don't know how I do them. I just do them." I says, "Well, keep on doing them. Thanks." And that was it. Yeah.
I was told to ask, what do you think of Mike Powers?
Mike Powers, is he in the room?
Now you can talk.
No, Mike's a good friend. Known him a lot. I know if I never need an attorney in any regard, I can go to him. But he's been a good personal friend for a long time. Right there, there was a guy named Steve Durbano, and I was 5-2 this late game. We were up in Pittsburgh, and he speared me right in the stomach. Here's what happens. We start fighting, and I'm up against the glass, and I'm trying to get at him any way I can. So, you know, he's trying to hit me, and there's people and all of the other guys on the ice watching. So I grab for his helmet, get the helmet off. Good. Got the helmet off. Now I can go for his hair. Like, so I get his hair like this, and I go, "Ooh." I thought I ripped his head off. He had a toupee on. And it was like time stood still. It was the best fight I ever had. It was like he looked at it, I looked at it. He looked at it, I looked at it. Players are going, "Ah!" People in the crowd are laughing. He grabs it out of my hand, sticks it on his head, and skates off the ice. So I go, you know, oh, this is cool. And then the referee goes, no, Gare, I don't know what to give you. I said, well, what? What? He says, I don't know, give you 5 minutes for rug pulling or toupee tugging. I'm not sure. I said, just get me off the ice, all right? So the auditorium is about the size of this stage. When that Patty scored his first goal as a Sabre, he goes like this to myself, and Barry Butel was the other radio guy. He puts his arms like this, like, shut up. You know, like, don't say a word. So I'm going, what the heck's this all about? He never does this. La, 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 Fontaine. I almost fell out of the box when he said that.
Pretty happy you were here today to really highlight an incredible day dealing with the Buffalo Sabres.
Thank you for having me. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Arneal charges after it. Arneal flips it out to center, a breakaway to Housley. Here's Housley going in on goal, cutting in front, he scores! I don't believe it! Two men short!
Assisted by number 7, Gary Ford, and number 6, Nate Leonard. Arneal, Ford, and Leonard.
Seven minutes later, Ryan Bourque on the rebound. That's Ray Bourque's son, making it 2-0 USA.
You see a name like Bourque out there, and you think of Ray Bourque, and the number of Norris trophies that you lost was yours because of Ray Bourque. What do you think of?
Well, I think it's just great to have a player like Bourque on our team. I mean, it's hereditary. A lot of the, you know, athletes, whatever sport you're playing, you get the your mom and dad's genes, and more importantly, Ray Bourque's genes. So, I just remember when I think of him, is all the times that we competed against each other in the old Garden in Boston, and truly was a remarkable player.
Has Ray been around?
He hasn't been around this year. I know he was around last year, and it'd be great to see him again. I know I played on a lot of All-Star teams with him, so I'd be happy to see him and share some old times.
Hey, I was reading this book. Maybe you've seen it. Then Perot Set to Rigo, and Wowie Howie is all over this book. And one of the things that you talked about was a game I sort of remember because you were my hero. Your first exhibition game was against Montreal, and there was a guy named Guy Lafleur out there. What was that like?
Well, you know, Montreal was my team growing up as a kid. I loved the Canadiens. They were, you know, perennial Stanley Cup winners, and Guy Lafleur was my idol. So it was quite awesome, to tell you the truth, lining up in pregame skate before the game, and being able to rub shoulders with Guy Lafleur, because he was standing right next to me when we were doing our three-line shooting drill, and you know, I had to sort of take a couple deep breaths and get my wits about me. But you know, it's one thing to have watch your idols, and another thing to play against them. But getting back to Gilbert, he was really best players, and he sort of took me under his wing. He asked me to come back to the bus my first year and sit with him and just talk about plays and how we could create offense from defense and with outlet passes and little plays that we worked on in practice. And he had a whole new dimension about the game and making plays offensively from our own end.
Until Mark Maldonado exceeded your mark regarding number of points as an American born. That's unbelievable that you had as many points as you had as a defensive role. I mean, even Maldonado was a forward.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it just shows that I've been able to play with a lot of great players that put me in that position. You know, I could go right down the list, too many names to mention, but certainly the start of it was with Gilbert and guys like Dave Vanderchuk and you know, Pierre Turgeon, just to name a few guys that you know, were around the power play, and a lot of coaches have put a lot of trust in me to run the power play, and But you know, you look back and reflect on your career, and I was quite happy, you know, being able to survive 21 years and being able to play on the power play and play with a lot of great players.
So you got drafted by the Sabres. Was that a surprise for you that Scotty would go after you?
Yeah, I was sort of surprised because it was, I think I was going to be going in the ninth round pick to Washington or Calgary at that time. Those were the teams that I heard that were going to pick me, and, you know, of course, Scotty picked me, and along with Seymour and Norty Knox, gave me a chance to play in the NHL, and I'm forever grateful for that.
When you started off that first year, I mean, you literally went from high school to the NHL. You're sort of the alkaline of hockey. You and Barrasso are really one of the few that ever do that. If you had to do it all over again, would you feel like you would need any seasoning? Clearly, your success would lead one to believe otherwise, but I mean, that's a big jump.
It was a big jump, but you know, I don't know if anybody knows this. In 1982, I was asked to try out for the national team, for Team USA, and a couple exhibition games, and I made the team, and playing against the pros, you know, before I was even drafted, and that was a big measuring stick for me, and I thought I was able to hold my own, and that's why I chose the route I did, and I have no regrets, you know, especially starting in Buffalo, a nice small town. Great fans, but more importantly, the players that I played with that took me under their wing. You know, I could name, you know, Mike Foligno, Lindy Ruff, Mike Ramsey, Larry Playfair. A lot of those guys really took me under their wing and showed me how to be a pro. And Lindy Ruff and Mike Ramsey took me into their house until I got my own place to live. And, you know, we were a tight-knit team. You know, we did a lot of things together. You know, on Halloween and the holidays, so that was a really made me feel comfortable as a player. You know, even being a rookie and getting ribbed a lot, they made me feel at home, and I was glad I started in Buffalo.
You recently were inducted into the Buffalo Hall of Fame, and part of the ceremonies was Scotty Bowman. What did Scotty Bowman mean to Phil Housley?
Well, Scotty Bowman gave me a chance to play. You know. The old story goes he was watching me with the St. Paul Vulcans when I played junior A after my high school year was over. My high school season was over, and he was standing around a bunch of college scouts. And to this day, I think this is the way the story went. He walked up to the college scouts and said, "I don't know what you're doing here. I'm picking them in the first round." So, but, you know, he was a pioneer in sorts, you know. Just as a track record alone speaks for itself, and he must have saw something in me and took a chance on me. And again, I'm grateful that he did, and really, you know, springboard my career.
Being such an offensive defenseman, did you learn much just from a technique perspective from a Gilbert Perreault, who was still obviously on the team when you were there, but sort of the latter part of his career?
Well, I just learned that positional play. You know, throughout my career and all the coaches I've had, I've had a great experience of different methods to coaching and position. I think every year I had to improve. You know, I had to really improve on my play away from the puck. And, you know, from one teacher in particular, Jacques Lemaire, and I was only in New Jersey for a short period, told me, you know, don't be trying to outmuscle a guy in the corner. You know, you contain him and don't spend your energy. And, it made perfect sense. Going away against the philosophy of trying to hit and pin guys, which for me, I probably wouldn't be able to do to the majority of the players in the NHL, and made perfect sense for me just to contain, not let them beat me back to the front of the net, and it was a great pointer.
You were the first round draft pick in 1982 in Buffalo. You stayed with them for 8 years, and then one day you were traded. Was that tough?
That was the toughest. The first time you get traded as a professional is the hardest, and you can ask anybody. You're never really prepared for it until you see the boxes packed in your house. And I know I broke down on that day, but you know it's another opportunity. You know, you go to a new team, you meet some new players and new friends, and that's the way I treated it. I was never bitter about any of the trades. You know, business is business, and at that point, I've had 8 years in the league, and. You understand that it's a business and a job, but it's also something that you love doing for life, and you would never change that, but there are parts of it that people don't see, like when you move to a new city, trying to get new schools, new doctors for your kids, you know, a place to live, those things people don't see, but you know, that was very difficult the first time.
Was it difficult to see Mark Maldonado go younger?
No, you know, and I was pushing for him. I knew JR and Mike Madonna, one of those two were going to break it, and I couldn't be happier for a guy like Mike Madonna, a very classy individual. He's going to carry the torch now, and I couldn't see anybody else carrying that that top scoring for an American plateau than Mike Madonna. And, you know, I was there wishing him well when the celebration in Dallas, when he was in Minnesota. Again, we had a celebration, so I'm very happy for him. He's had an outstanding career. I just want to say Jamestown's an excellent city, a great facility here. We were happy to be come over here and play Norway, and the result was always great.
And Ray goes back in there. He wants Hector Snow. It was Snow, I believe, who nailed him from behind, and there they go again.
It's been mentioned to me by people, let's see, people in high places that I shouldn't make fights sound so excited.
On the ice, whether you score a goal or a big fight, it's almost like you'd kind of race to get to the room to replay the tape just to see how Rick, you know, said what was going on. And
Ray and Bonvy trying to exchange punches. Meanwhile, down on the ice goes Smolik. He tries to get up again, but down is Bonvy as Ray applies the coup de grace.
And if it's bothering you that much, then take fighting out of the game. Don't blame me if they start fighting. I didn't tell them to fight.
There's no class for doing it. It's,
how does one learn?
It's all nice experience, job experience. But no, you know, it was just something you watched and you listened and you tried to talk to as many people as possible and hands-on training. That's pretty much all it was. I can remember nights that, you know, you're skating up and you're like, what the hell am I doing? You know, because you can't see, you're puffy, you know, your hands are sore. And you know, you're thinking to myself, is this really what I want? And then the next morning you wake up and I was like, yeah, that's what I want. So you went back and did the same thing. But there's no formal training, trust me, for playing this role, because you don't go to practice and pick out somebody and get in a fight with them just to practice, you know, for the next day's game. It's very difficult, and it's something that you have to learn to take a punch, not only give one, but take one's more important.
So they bring you up your first game. October 21st, 1989, you're playing the Pittsburgh Penguins. Tom Barrasso, former Sabres, their goalie. And they're bringing you up to be an enforcer. And then now your first shot on goal.
First shift, first shot, I scored a goal. I was like, what the? What took me so long? You know, this is going to be easy. And actually, at times during the game, I had thoughts going through my mind. I'm going, like, Gretzky, maybe he's not as good as I thought he was. So I was able to do that. And that night, I got a goal and assist, and I was plus three. And statistically wise, it was the best game I ever had in the NHL. It was my first game. So it went downhill from there.
You had 2,897 penalty minutes with the Sabres, which I think is still an NHL record with a single team. Yeah. But is it congratulations?
It was over 3,000.
Well, total, yeah. With the, and, oh, well, yeah, 3,207, it's take a bow. And
hang my hat on that.
But okay.
Kid.
So, but Rob Ray is out in the public. You're a well-known name, and this is even during your playing games. Did guys ever want to come up and?
Never. honest to God, I never had that problem. The closest I had one night, it was when the night Matthew Barnaby got called up, and he was all proud. He had a new suit on and everything, and he was just thought he was in the top of the world. And I had knee surgery at the time. That was the reason he got called up. And so we go out one night, and these guys, they weren't really looking good, but Matthew got all brave and thought he was going to show everybody, you know, how cool a guy he was, and they actually took him outside and kicked it. And he's like, where were you guys? And he comes walking in, his brand new suit's got the arm ripped out, and he's all tore up, and he's banged up. We take him to the rink the next day, we had to make an excuse that we got fooling around, that, you know, he got banged up that way, but no. I never had that problem, never did.
Most joyous moment?
I think, obviously your first game, you know, type thing, but other than that, I think it was that same season. When we beat Toronto to in the conference final to go to the Stanley Cup, we were in Toronto. And it was, when you go to Toronto, you ride the bus. You bus up. And that ride from Toronto home, it seemed like it was 8 hours long. But it was the funnest time and the closest I've ever been to a bunch of guys and how excited everybody was. And you know, it was just unbelievable. It was like you're contained in this little capsule and, you know, the happiest 30 guys in the world right at that moment, you know, with coaching and trainees and the players. And it was something that you didn't want to get off the bus. When it was all, when you hit Buffalo, it was like it was a disappointment because you had to get off and, you know, head your own way. So that was the neatest, just getting that opportunity.
And then during that series with Toronto, during game four, you scored four goals.
Single-handedly broke the Leafs back. Yeah. No, it was fun. It was good, and you got the opportunity. And, you know, just I think any person, when they play a sport, they just want to feel like they did their part and be a part of it. And, you know, that was my opportunity. Well, because he is a guy that, you know, makes it so exciting. And, you know, he did so many years on the radio that, you know, he had to present it in a way to keep the attention of the people from not watching it. And he's, you know, I say he's the best in the business out there. You know, you hear an awful lot of guys and you listen to watch TV all the time and it's not even close. I still say the league's missing out on the boat by not using a guy like Rick Jeanneret in national broadcast. You know, you've got Versus, which, you know, it struggles because, you know, people don't pay attention to it. Nothing against Doc Emmerich, but he's boring and he sits there and he talks about everything but the game. I'm thinking if you had a guy like Rick Jeanneret, doing the game and people are flipping through and they're hearing this guy, you know, it would stop them. It would stop them to listen, you know, whether it was the game or not. They would stop and listen to him. And, you know, I constantly tell that to the people and, you know, that they're missing the boat not having a guy like Rick, you know, present the game in a national stage because I think you could attract so many more people doing it. But on the other hand, Rick Jeanneret owes the players for making him. Pavel Fontaine, you know, Brad May, the fights, the goals. If it wasn't for that, Rick Jeanneret would still be at Clancy's in Niagara Falls. Clancy's a little bar that he likes going to. I tell him that all the time. Yeah. He gets mad.
Yeah. Hence, he's grumpy.
Yeah.
Talk to me about the French Connection.
I didn't even know who the French Connection were when I came here. And quickly I found out about them. And Gilbert Perreault, to start with, is still a guy that... The problem is with Gilbert when he left, and it was with the Knoxes, that they left on bad note. And it wasn't something that was fixed until years later. And now it's turned back to a little bit of that sour note again. And it's unfortunate because as a player, we look at Gilbert, and most of us never played with him, but we look at him, and when you talk Buffalo Sabres, you think Gilbert Perreault. Nobody else you think is Gilbert Perreault. To have a guy like him around, it's awesome, and he's the funniest guy that you ever going to meet, and you know he's around, and now all he thinks about is casino and you know sell my equipment and you know all that kind of thing. But he's so sincere, and he still to this day when he's in town and you talk to him about the team, he follows the team to a T. He knows exactly what's going on. He's got an opinion about, you know, what he thinks, you know, right or wrong is going on. And he still has that passion for the Sabres. And I think that's awesome.
Rob, you may not know this, but during the 90s, there was always this guy right on ice who was heckling you all the time and all over your case. And we brought him here especially today to ask you a question. Yeah, and he brought his bodyguards with him as well, so... I'll introduce you to John Lloyd. John, if you're dude stand, he's the guy that was heckling you, don't they? Yeah, that was the guy. Remember you're talking about, is there this guy from
James? Just look at him in. Just look at him. There's no sense of fear whatsoever coming from that body.
John, do you have a question or your bodyguards have a question?
Bodyguard grew out through his hair.
From Hockey Digest, and they asked you the funniest hockey memory, and you started with that time in Quebec City about 15 years ago. Talk about that.
That was a totally different situation. There's a fight on the ice. There was a five-on-five fight. Clint Boarchuk and Herb Ragel, and those guys were fighting on the ice. And, you know, while we're all watching it, this guy climbed up on the glass behind the bench, and he was sitting there. And John Muckler, we all kind of noticed at the same time, and Mucks grabbed a stick, and he was running down the bench. He was going to hit the guy to knock him back into the stands. The last second, he drove into the bench. And we literally grabbed on him, threw him on the ice, thinking it was over with. He jumps from the ice, comes running back, and tries jumping back into the bench. And that's when he came to us, and, you know, we ended up fighting him. I had a hair, ball of hair, and, you know, hit him so many times, and he just kind of dropped to the ice. And the police were out there jumping on him and wrestling around with him. And the bullets were falling out of the holsters of the police, and they're laying all over the ice. And we're sitting there going, what the hell is, what's this all about, you know? And it was something that happened so quick, and it was over with.
My mom, God bless her, is still very much around, and she never hid the cookies on me, but she certainly limited the number I could have.
Well, you've been categorized as Mr. Intangible. I've seen that. Michael Peca, Mr. Intangible. Why did you get that kind of moniker?
You know, if I think about it, I think it's when you look at players that have, you know, intangible qualities, I think, you know, I think there's a level of intelligence to the hockey game. It's understanding the game. It's appreciating the little things in the game. And if you have a very well-rounded, very disciplined game, I think it's easy to get that attachment intangible because if you're strong defensively, you're strong on faceoffs, you block shots, you finish your checks. I mean, they're all little things you teach kids at a young age and you hope they adapt and grow that. Not everything sticks with everybody. So, you know, ever since I can remember being 12, 13 years old, I want to be on the ice in every key situation. Mm-hmm. I remember that. And so I really tried to mold my game. So if it was an offensive situation, the coach wanted me out there. If it was a defensive situation, the coach wanted me out there. Regardless of, you know, if we were power play, penalty kill, didn't matter. So I think that's maybe part of the reason that happened.
Well, the two Selke trophies is terrific and a plus 66. Over your lifetime, that's an amazing number. Did that strike you?
It does in a sense because there's a stretch of time there for about a decade where, you know, I had great line mates who committed themselves defensively as well. Great goaltenders, Dominic Hasek being one of them. Yeah, but it's surprising in a sense because you're going against the Forsbergs, the Lemieux, the Yagers, the Matt Sundins, the Mike Modanos, and those are guys that scored an awful lot of points in the National Hockey League. So. To be on the positive side of the plus-minus ledger, I think, was a great accomplishment, not just for me, but the guys that I played with.
I was sitting in the odd, and we were actually passing up the Stanley Cup. In the ceremonies, everybody hung around because nobody expected they'd ever see a Stanley Cup in Buffalo, and mm-hmm. Here's one. And then all of a sudden, Lindy Ruff comes out and starts going bananas. I mean, unbelievably pounding the board, bananas. I've never asked, what was going on in the locker room after the game is over, you leave? Was there discussion about that?
Well, to start at the end of that too, Lindy actually followed me out to the bench. I was actually the first one that was out there yelling at Gary Bettman, and Lindy was right behind me, I think stuck around a little bit. But what happened was, being on the bench at the time when the goal was scored, the NHL, who controls the Zamboni doors in the Stanley Cup final, the arena facility staff no longer has that control. Because they want to capture the moment when the goal scored and the Stanley Cup and all that. So we just thought it was over. But when we got inside and started looking at the review, the replay, we realized that a goal was scored that had been disallowed, not just throughout the playoffs, but the entire second half of the regular season. So, you know, I think emotions were as high as they were going to be on a negative level because we just lost and there's a tremendous amount of disappointment. And I think that fueled the need to get a question answered. And so we stormed out there. There wasn't a goal. His foot was in the crease, you know, and this and that and the other thing. And probably not the way you should speak to a commissioner of a league when you're 5 feet away from him. But all the same, it happened. And so I think we lived a very disappointing moment at the time. I think everybody agreed that it was a bad rule, but a rule all the same, that in that same playoff season, goals were being disallowed left and right because a foot was in the crease. Even when a guy was one-on-one with the goalie, it happened. So it was just an overall disappointing moment.
So what did you say to Bettman?
Can't say. but the funny thing was is a week later, I'd just run into him face-to-face at the NHL Awards at the Air Canada Center. And he'd come up to me and said, hey, Michael, you and I need to have a talk. And, you know, I was still pretty upset when I saw him. I said, well, unless it's about you apologizing for the way things played out in Buffalo, I said, we have nothing to say to each other. And that was the end of it.
Ted Nolan was with the Sabres for a couple of years and then disappeared literally from hockey. Why?
I'm not sure. You know, that's one of those things that's been speculated on for a long time. You know, I think in a nutshell, it was a coach and a general manager and Ted Nolan and John Mucklew that just didn't work well. You know, and anytime you're a coach and you go over your general manager's head, whether it's the president or the ownership group, other GMs are going to find out about that. And I think the thing that hurt Ted was GMs were just afraid to hire a guy that didn't honor the protocol and the chain of command. And I think that's what kept him out of the game for a long time. There are just people that have been around the game of hockey that just make moments special, and Rick's one of those guys. I mean, for me, when I was growing up, hockey to me meant Bob Cole and Harry Neal on Hockey Night in Canada. And every time I saw the Leafs, I just thought of those guys. And as I was growing up, I mentioned listening to Ted Darling on the radio. But Rick Jenner has been that for the Buffalo Sabres as well. He's just got a very loving and unique way of calling games. And he's a special guy. He has so much passion for what he does, and it shows. But Dominic Kasich was just, you know, the way I kind of evaluate his ability and what he meant to the game is he revolutionized the position. I think as any player in any sport, if you can revolutionize a particular position, then you're excellent and you're special. And Dominic Kasich did that. Nobody played the game the way he did. When I grew up, it was Steve Yzerman. He was just always the type of guy that I loved to watch play, and just seemed to have the same level of humility that I had as a young boy, and really tried to emulate the way he played.
You teamed with Steve at the Olympics in 2002. Was that your highlight?
It was. It was a very cool moment. In early September, we were in Calgary, and we had our orientation camp with Team Canada. And Steve and I sat next together in the locker room, and I'd met him briefly before that. We started talking. I told him how I was always a big fan of his when I was a kid, not to make him feel old, but, you know, then Pat Quinn came in, and he says, all right, you guys are going to play together for the scrimmage today. Michael, you're in the center, and Steve, you're on the left wing. And I remember saying, hey, whoa, I said, I'm not going to center, you know, Steve Yzerman. I said, I'll go on the wing. He'll be the centerman. And in such a classic moment, Steve said, don't worry, when the tournament comes around, I'll be playing with Mario, so don't worry about it. Well, so it kind of made me feel, all right, that's okay, then you go on the wing. That's how you feel. The gold medal is a moment that every 2 years when there's an Olympic event, whether it's summer or winter Olympics, and you can think back and you know, and I reminisce with my kids that I'm an Olympic gold medalist, and there's something very special about that. But from the age of 9, 10 years old, all I ever wanted to do was hoist a Stanley Cup. The thing that hurts most is 99 with Buffalo hurt, but not nearly as much as Edmonton in 2005 because 2006 because we were in a game 7 and we could have won the Stanley Cup. Buffalo, we could have extended it another game, but in Edmonton we had it in that game. We had a chance to win a Stanley Cup, and you know, rarely does a day or two go by that I don't think of that game still. It still doesn't eat at me anymore, but I think about it a lot and think what could have been, you know, how things could have been different.
Michael Peca in the Sabres orbit is wonderful because you were so popular here. Was it hard during 2000, 2001 when you just couldn't come to agreement with the Regis organization?
It was very painful because things could have been handled so much more differently, and not just on the management side, but on my side as well. And, you know, I had a high profile player agent that had a game plan, and I was on board with that game plan. But I think, you know, from what I've been told is, you know, ownership felt that they had all the control as per the CBA regulations, and they knew that my wife was there. We had our roots, deep into the ground in Buffalo, that they were just going to make me sit and wait. And You know, a line I always use with my kids is, I'm not the guy to play chicken with because I'll never back down.
Mm-hmm.
So it got to a point where it was a matter of principle, and it wasn't the money, and it wasn't anything else but principle. And I just, you know, once I found that out, I just felt like I couldn't, in good conscience, walk back in that locker room and play hard for that ownership group.
Did you get any tips from Rob Ray?
I've never taken advice from Rob Ray. He's one guy that I've always considered. I don't think there's anything Rob can lend. And no, I'm just kidding. Rob was a guy who you can tell cared. I mean, he was a guy that cared about the team, the organization, the community. And I'm very good friends with Rob still today, and that still comes out of him. You can tell the way he does the broadcast, and it's going to be exciting to hear him up with Rick Jenneret this year, because I think he's gotten so comfortable behind the microphone, and his perspective is so deep. That he's a lot of fun to listen to. But Rob is just the kind of guy, I think, that showed me that it's okay to be hard on your teammates if it's done the right way. And he was like that. He was a guy in the locker room when I was a young captain, wasn't very vocal. He was very supportive in that respect. He'd hold guys accountable, but he'd do it in the right way. And I learned a lot from that.
You're terrific.
Thank you.
Thank you.
5 seconds remaining in the penalty. Now Peca steps back on again, and Buffalo kills off another. Here comes Peca! Oh, he leveled Domi! Peca stepped out of the penalty box and absolutely smoked Ty Domi!
So Tyler, the biggest question we have is, what do you think of Kevin Adams?
Where have you been?
Yeah. You have to wait to ask me when he's not standing next to me. Just kidding.
How did you connect with him?
Was actually helping out Tyler Ennis, because Kev used to be with O2K, and Tyler was with O2K, and so I met Kev through Tyler, and then I saw him every now and again, and then he got the job with the Sabres, and I saw him more and more, and you know, he's just been helping me out since.
They refer to you as the Big Easy. Why is that? Because of Kevin?
No, not because of Kev. Last year, my rookie year, I guess, I think it was Mike Greer was the guy that started calling me the Big Easy. Just, I guess on the ice, I made things look easy at times, so he just started calling me the Big Easy.
You had a terrific year, especially last year with the Calder Trophy. Was that a surprise when they announced your name?
Thank you very much.
Definitely wasn't expecting that going into last year. You know, even to this day, I sometimes think about it and really can't believe it. So, you know, it's definitely a year I won't forget.
You had a pretty fast rise through the system here, Tyler. Was hockey always your sport, by the way?
It was always my number one sport. When I was younger, I was playing baseball, soccer, basketball, volleyball, you know, and hockey. So, you know, I was always, I always enjoyed, you know, basically all sports. But, you know, as I got older, hockey took over and I had to drop the other ones.
Yeah. As you go through this, were you surprised when the Sabres picked you? Because they obviously tried to go through the process of moving up in the draft to get you. Did they, you know, that was coming?
When the first selection of 2008 draft.
I didn't have a clue who was going to draft me on draft day. You know, Kim Gellert, who's a scout with Buffalo, was also my skills coach in Kelowna. So, you know, he was at the draft, and I was actually sitting right by their table. So when they got, when it was their turn to walk up, he was walking up, took a look at me and gave me the nod. So he kind of ruined the surprise for me, but you know, at the same time, I was very excited, and when they called my name, you know, I was pretty happy.
It didn't take long for you to get hit the Sabres themselves. I mean it's really a remarkable rise. Do you remember your first goal? I mean, do you remember that?
Yeah, I do. It was clear as day. I remember you know, Dan Pye had a good forecheck, and then, you know, I just snuck into the slot, and I was lucky that the puck came to me, and I just basically backhanded it towards the net, and luckily it went in.
Do you still have the puck?
I do, yeah.
Do you keep many things? Are you a collector?
Yeah, actually, I keep a lot of jerseys, actually. You know, my parents, you know, they frame them all and have them all hanging in my basement. So, you know, it's pretty cool to go back home and, you know, go down to the basement and see all my jerseys, you know, from even from when I was younger and seeing them, you know, as I got older. So it's pretty cool.
Having made Team Canada and obviously met a lot of players, was there a role model for you?
Well, when I was really young, you know, I was a forward to start out, so Steve Yzerman was always the guy I, you know, I would look up to. And it's funny now because, you know, I've met him, you know, playing in the league, and it's, you know, it's weird for me, but when I made the jump from forward to D, Nick Lindstrom, you know, obviously he was a guy, and you know, it's very strange playing against him.
Yeah,
so I was always a Wings fan, and you know, obviously a Stars fan when I grew up in Texas, and you know, it's kind of embarrassing to say it now, but I was rooting for the Stars in 99 when they beat Buffalo.
So when the Stars played the Buffalo and Brett Hall hit the no goal, you were there for you?
Yeah, I started cheering. you know, it's a little strange now, you know, playing for the Sabres, being a Stars fan at that time.
You've just had several people ask for your autograph. You know, what's that mean to you?
You know, it's happened the last, you know, 2 years, so, you know, I've kind of gotten used to it, but, you know, I sometimes think about it, and it's, you know, it's funny how, you know, you run into people and they're asking you for your signature, so, you know, it's still something I really, you know, haven't gotten used to, but, you know, it's pretty exciting.
You were involved with Team Canada on the 18 and under team. No doubt you followed what happened in Buffalo there. What was your reaction when the day was done and the Russians came storming back to beat the Canadians in the finals this past year? Did you get a...
At the World Juniors?
Yeah.
I wasn't too happy. I remember I was in Colorado and I was watching the game on TV, and you know, I thought, you know, it was looking good going into the third, but it was a pretty devastating loss.
What do your parents think about all this stuff here?
They're pretty proud of me. You know, and they tell me they're proud of me, so it's nice to have their support, and you know, it's exciting to bring them out to Buffalo and you know, have them watch games live.
Thank you, Tyler.
Yeah, no problem.
Appreciate it.
I'm known around the world of hockey for a couple of things, even to this day. One of them still lives on. Does anybody know the name of the Japanese hockey player that was drafted by Buffalo? No? I guess. Nobody remembers Taro Tujimoto?
No.
Greg does, anyway. That's one. Thanks, Greg. In training camp one year, or after training camp, I'm sorry, or during the amateur draft, we had a draft and do a phone draft to pick players instead of meeting in a room like this with all the teams. So it was, I won't go into why, but it was an arcane reason. When it came time for Buffalo to draft late in the rounds, general manager Punchimlak was very disgusted by having to wait for this phone thing to go through all the time. So he said, why don't we draft somebody that doesn't exist? And give them a good name, and then they have to repeat the name to all the other coaches when they go around again. So I decided that it would be fun to have a Japanese hockey player. There used to be a Japanese gardens or a garden store in Elma, New York, with the name Tujimoto's. It was on Route 16. And I said, that's a good last name, and Taro would be a good first name. And so we drafted Taro Tujimoto, and instantly I made up this persona with the height, the weight, goals, assists, played for the Tokyo Katanas, you know. And so every time that, so we drafted him, and of course we had to spell the name to the Clarence Campbell, who ironically was a member of the prosecution team as Justice Jackson was in Nuremberg. Clarence Campbell was the president of the NHL at the time, Canadian lawyer from Montreal, and a very stuffy guy. And he had to get, so we spelled the name over the phone to him. That's T-A-R-O-T-S-U-J-I-M-O-T-O. Could you repeat that, Mr. Imlach? T-A-R-O, you know. So then he had to give it, I think there was 20 teams in the league then. He had to repeat that to each one of the 20 teams over the phone. So he was drafted. Taro was drafted. And we never even told the owners, Seymour and Norty Knox, that there was no such person as Taro Tujimoto. And in fact, we set it up with the trainers so that in training camp that year, I set it up actually. I'd like to spread the wealth here, but I didn't. And we had a stall for him. He was in the training camp guide. We got equipment hanging for him. And everything, you know. So the owners said, is he coming to his training camp or not? And we said, well, I don't know. Maybe he'll show up. Of course, he didn't show up, but we were in St. Catharines, Ontario, up the road in Buffalo. And we're staying at a Holiday Inn. The whole team was staying there. And Seymour was having lunch with his brother Norty in the coffee shop. And there happened to be a fella in there, I assume he was Canadian, but he was definitely Japanese. And when I had this brilliant idea when he watched him very closely. And when he got up to leave, pay his bill, I had Taro Tujimoto page from the front desk. And you should have seen those Knoxes go out the door after him. And this poor guy, he didn't know what was from any place. Well, I was, myself and Floyd Smith, who was coaching Buffalo at the time, was in on the gag. We were laughing so hard, we practically were rolling on the floor because they thought they had found Taro Tujimoto. That's the kind of nonsense I involved myself in. I used to pull April Fool's jokes, and I did, one year I know you get a lot of sports out of this, by the way, but I really don't know about the jokes. So I used to send out these fake news releases every April 1st, and that's not uncommon, particularly in Europe in the media. Many of you might know that. But we would send out a release, and one of my favorites was the year that you always take a kernel of reality when you work in this business, PR business, if you're going to do a joke. So they were putting in a brand new ice surface, taking all the piping and Memorial Auditorium, the old place where the Sabres play. So I thought that was interesting. So we can work this out. So I sent out a release announcing that we were going to be the first team in NHL history and pro hockey history to skate on plastic ice. They're going to put it, maybe some of you have been in a mall or something where they have like a little exhibition. Actually, there is a product, a couple products that are like plastic ice. They try and skate on them. Seriously, I'm not kidding. But my ice was called Slider X. So we sent out a release, and I had it, it was invented by a guy named, Ramsay MacDonald, former Prime Minister of Great Britain, but in his cow barn in Pictou County, Nova Scotia. That's where he came up with the chemical formula for the plastic ice. I always put, you know, three or four paragraphs in, I put some silly thing in there so I wouldn't catch the media. Well, guess what? I did. I caught the New York Times. I caught a CBS station in Philadelphia. And most importantly, I caught poor Mr. Campbell, who was the president of the league, was sitting in his office in Montreal. And he got a phone call from the Canadian Press, which is like the Associated Press in Canada, asking him for comment on the fact that Buffalo was going to play next year on a new surface on plastic ice. Well, Mr. Campbell harumphed a few times and said, and I almost remember the quote that they read to me over the phone, well, of course, we've always been in the forefront of innovation in the National Hockey League. while I'm not knowledgeable of this particular product, I'm sure that the Buffalo franchise knows what it's doing. And, you know. Now, I don't want to embarrass somebody like that. He was a nice man. So Canadian Press called me, and I said, don't use the boat. I said, that's not fair. I mean, you just called him. You might have been busier now or whatever. He just was giving you sort of a stock answer, you know. So they didn't, but they read me the quote. But I did catch a few other people, and including someone who many of you will know when I tell you his name. He was a sports director and still emeritus now at Channel 2, Ed Kilgore. And the release on Slide Directs was for Saturday morning, April 1st, whatever the year was. I don't remember the year. And it said for release at 7 a.m., April 1st, you know, whatever. Friday night comes, sports come on Channel 2 at 6:15, 6:20. Ed Kilgore leads his sportscast with something Channel 2 News has exclusively learned, that the Sabres will be playing on plastic ice next year. Well, I'm sitting at home, because I used to monitor the sportscast as a PR guy. Now I start to laugh. My wife is, what's it been? I was, the tears were rolling out. You know? I was laughing so hard. So I composed myself after he went off the air, and I hit his private number, and I called his private number, and I said, Ed, this is Paul Wieland. And he said, yeah, Paul, what? And I said, I'm really mad at you. And he said, why? I said, you broke my release date. That's not supposed to be out until tomorrow morning. You know, see, he's still not sure whether he got taken. No, he is sure he got taken. It was, you know, it was my favorite moment, actually. Another time I almost got charged with a federal crime for an April Fool's joke. Seriously. I put out a release one year, and I had a friend of mine who was a commercial artist, did a lot of work for me, and the Sabres, and he got a hold of some White House stationery. Ronald Reagan was president, and we had actual letter back from the White House to somebody. So he went into the magic of being a commercial artist, and we came up with clean White House letterhead, and we put in, and we had the president's name, which was signed by probably a mechanical signing device. And we put out a proclamation from the White House declaring the Sabres America's hockey team. We sent, not the Dallas Cowboys, they're football. You know, America's hockey team was the Sabres. So we sent out a release, and we had decals made for your windows and your car. They were red, white, and blue with a little Sabres emblem on them. And we had fake Time magazine covers made showing Gilbert Perreault, who was in that little clip. As you know, it said Times, you know, America's hockey team story inside page 3, you know, and it would look like a real Time magazine cover. They were really expensive to have done, by the way, and we sent those to a lot of people. And about 2 days on Monday, I got a call, or Tuesday, 2 days later, I got a call from the Associated Press in Washington. The assistant press secretary had announced that some idiot in Buffalo was going to be charged me. Two things you can't do. One is you can't sign the president's name, right? And the other is you can't use White House stationery. So my response to the Associated Press was, geez, I hope they arrest me. It's going to be an even bigger story.
Like most young boys growing up in Waterloo, Ontario, Jim Lorentz dreamed of making it to the National Hockey League one day. His dream came true in 1968 when he earned a spot on the Boston Bruins roster. That was a team that had players like Johnny Vucic, Wayne Cashman, Bobby Orr, and Phil Esposito on its roster. After stints with the St. Louis Blues and the New York Rangers, the Rangers traded him to the Buffalo Sabres, where he established himself as an everyday player. He skated alongside Craig Ramsey and Don Luce, one of the best defensive lines ever put together by the Sabres, or in the league for that matter. He found time to score 134 goals and over 300 points in his 6 seasons in Buffalo. Retired after the 1977-78 season.
I forgot we'd done all those crazy things there. That.
Do you miss Rick?
Oh yeah. He was, or he is, very, very bright guy, and someone who had impeccable timing,
and anybody who has listened to him for so many years will know. And he probably the most exciting broadcaster in the game. So, and I think the reason why we gelled so well is because both of us had the same idea about the game of hockey, and you heard it on the tape there about it is entertaining, but the game is still the most important thing. And what I found in some of the broadcasts today is that the announcers think that what they have to say is more important than the game. And Rick and I think over the years tried to always let the game tell the story, and we would just sort of guide it along.
Commonville into Ottawa territory. Commonville goes around Alfredson, cuts in front, scores! Jason Commonville, shorthanded. Oh, now do you believe? Now do you believe? These guys are good, scary good.
When Commonville scored the goal, I think it was just off the cuff. And that's what his brilliance was. You never knew what he was going to say or how he was going to react to something. And some of his fighting calls are just classics. And it was just a lot of fun working. We had some real good times. I received word that Emil wanted to see me in the after the second period. So I knew something was up. So I walked down to the dressing room in the old auditorium. He had the visitor's room. And as you walked down the hall, there was another small room went just off to the left. So I waited in there, and Emil came in. He sat down. He said, "Jimmy boy," he talked like that, "I just treated you to the Buffalo Sabres right here." Well, I could have kissed him because having played all my junior hockey in Niagara Falls, I had, you know, of course, close connections to Buffalo, and I knew with the Sabres that I'd get a chance to play, and that's all I wanted to do. And that was the one team that I wanted to be traded to. So Emil wished me luck. He got up, walked out of the room. In the meantime, I, of course, wanted to tell my friends and my family, but I had gone around into the washroom, and the trainer comes by the door, looks in, doesn't see anyone in there, shuts the door and locks the friggin' door. So I was locked. Here I am, traded to the Buffalo Sabres. I'm just bursting with joy and energy. I come out, and I couldn't get out of the room, and I was pounding on the door. I remember pounding on the door for 5 minutes, and of course the team had already gone back on the ice by then, and there I was, and I never got out till the end of the game. So that was a memorable night for me, believe me, in more ways than one. It was one of the finest, nicest people you'd ever want to meet. I can remember, I used to play the power plays, and I'd say it was the only time I got to play with Gilbert, but because Rene Robert would play the point, so they'd move me up front. So I can still remember saying to Gilbert, I says, "Okay, the faceoff's in the Philadelphia zone or something to the right of the goaltender." I says, "Gilbert, where do you want me to stand on this faceoff?" Dead serious. And he looked at me and he said, "Jimmy, anywhere you want." Richard, on the other hand, was very, very intense, and one of the great goal scorers in the game, and one of those guys that when he was on the ice, he wanted the puck, and he had one thing in mind, and that was to score a goal. And Rene Robert really complimented that line as a very, very smart player, and maybe the best point man I ever played with outside of Bobby Orr, of course. Yeah, well, some of the stories I can't tell, but
try one or two.
I remember one night, I don't remember who we were playing, but he was named one of the stars. And he had the, for whatever reason, the responders, I forget what they call them, that would bring a stretcher out onto the ice. Anyways, Eddie laid down on the stretcher and had these people like shove him out on the ice. So, so there, I mean, he was another wing nut. Used to drive Craig Ramsey nuts because Craig Ramsey is very, very quiet, hardly said a word. And Eddie Schacht used to call him John. And Eddie had a very high-pitched voice. He said, "Come on, John, just say something. Just say something." I can still hear him talking in the dressing room. It just used to drive Ramsey nuts. Timmy Horton and Brian Spencer were the two strongest people I've ever met. And one night, we came into New York. We were going to play the Rangers. We played in Buffalo, and we got in late. It's probably 2 in the morning. Everybody goes to the lobby, gets their keys, goes to the room. Well, for whatever reason, there was a mix-up, and they had us in the wrong rooms, and I had gone downstairs with my roommate. And all of a sudden, the elevator doors open, and Timmy Horton walks out, and you've seen, like, the pop machines? He was carrying a pop machine. He took the whole thing and set it in the middle of the lobby. And he liked to drink scotch and soda. And he looked at the person behind the desk and he said, "There's no soda in this machine." And he turned around and walked, got back in the elevator and went upstairs. I'm forever remembered by many people as Batman for striking that bat. I remember the bat. It started early in the game. It was dive-bombing the crowd. And as you saw in the picture there, this was, I think, in the second period when I did away with it. The bat had lost a lot of energy and was flying in a straight line. There was a face-off, and I looked down, and I could see it coming down the ice, and I struck it. But before that happened, there were other times when the bat came down towards the ice, and I still remember Bernie Perrant had a couple of chances at it and missed it. And I said, that's the only thing that he missed in that series was that bat. But one of the highlights of my career, but the signing game was played in Buffalo, and we lost that. But in the third period, in unison, the crowd began to chant, "Thank you, Sabres." And that was really gratifying for a player to be involved in something like that. And it's something I'll never forget. My most enjoyable year in hockey. Even though I had won a Stanley Cup with Boston, and that was an incredible feeling. That 74-75 season was just exciting right from start to finish. And I think being a bigger part of it made it one of the most enjoyable times. And my biggest regret, really, was not to win the Stanley Cup, because you don't get many chances. And I think I was spoiled as a rookie winning a cup with Boston. You think, well, this is going to happen pretty regular, and it doesn't. And that's a simple fact. And you know, I had two chances to win the cup, and the one I really wanted to win was the one in Buffalo, and we just didn't get it done, but it was my most enjoyable year.
To Jim Lorentz, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Forever enshrined in the Greater Buffalo Sports Hall of Fame.
Ladies and gentlemen, Rene Robert.
Yeah. Robert going in on goal. Right in on goal. He gets it.
Red Kelly was coaching, and wouldn't put me back in the lineup. And make a long story short, we practicing one day, and we're coming one-on-one on Kelly, and I deked him, and he grabbed my arm, so I punched him.
You get this straight. You punched the coach?
Yeah.
Okay,
and,
sure.
And that was my last of the Pittsburgh Penguins. I guess there's a destiny in life, and Nemlock was always after me, so he got me back in Buffalo, and when I came to Buffalo, I had never played wing, and he said...
Now you were traded, by the way, for...
Eddie Shack, the entertainer, yeah.
Yeah.
So I came to Buffalo, and he said, "We're going to play you on the right side with Pearl and Martin." And I said, "Well, I really don't know what to do." And he says, "Just be a garbage collector."
Up over the line, going after it is Robert. He's got Savard with him. He steps to the line. There's the slap shot. He scores! Rene Robert!
Here he comes, Rene Robert, trying to slip right between our defense. Score!
You can't map a hockey game. It's just impossible to do, because you're going 20, 25, 30 miles an hour, and the puck is traveling at 100 miles an hour. It's not like a set play in football where you can call a timeout and say, "We have the ball." You can pretty much set the plays to what you're going to do. In hockey, if they call a timeout, there's a face-off in the far end. You're hoping that you're going to get the face-off. Then if you do, you have a chance to accomplish what was discussed at the bench, but 9 out of 10, it doesn't happen. It's just tough. He was like a warden in prison. We never had a day off with him, like, and no water on the bench, no ice, no nothing. And he was always watching from the corners, the corner with his binoculars, and if he saw someone sipping some water, he'd come charging in and give us a hard time. But as far as a human being, as a person, he was as loyal as anyone I've ever met. Roger was our key. He was our backbone, and had Roger stayed healthy, I do believe we would have won the Stanley Cup. He was a great goaltender, but unfortunately he had a pancreas problem and couldn't carry the load when we needed him.
Measurement. Did you know that was coming?
No. I had no idea. I didn't even know that pads were a certain, they had to be a certain size. But what I found out later, because Joe and I are still in contact, I go visit him every week. He told me that the morning skate, he happened to sneak into the Montreal Canadian rooms and measured the pads. So that was his ace in the hole. He waited for the right opportunity to call him on it, and it paid off.
Perreault sent Robert in alone on Ken Dryden, and he beat the Canadiens goalie with a shot that had them celebrating to the wee small hours back in Buffalo.
He got here and he traded me, Rico, and Danny.
How'd you feel?
Awful, and I still do. I'll hate him the rest of my life for what he did. He took away, and I firmly blame, I'm not saying this because I'm bitter, I'm over the bitterness part of it. But he took away from the fans of Buffalo. I firmly believe that when he came to Buffalo, he had the ingredients to win the Stanley Cup, and he just destroyed the team. Don Cherry is, he's what you see on TV is what you get. He loves himself. Then we go to Montreal after that, and we beat Montreal too. And then we're coming to Toronto after. So after we beat Montreal, he took us all drinking till 2 o'clock in the morning. So when we got back to the hotel on the bus, he says, "Oh, by the way, we're on the ice at 6:30. But, you know, that was his way of having fun watching the guys barf on the side of the road.
And I'm going to throw some names out. Give me your best story about these guys, okay?
I have Alzheimer.
We'll start with Don Luce.
And we called him the Blade because his blade was probably 5 inches high. But he, you know, couldn't shoot. He'd shoot, the puck was all wobbly, but he'd still score goals. So that's, and he had that big burry head, if you recall that. So, and he ate chocolate and coke. Never had a beer in his life. Craig Ramsey, probably the best penalty killer that I've seen in the NHL. Kind of a dry sense of humor. Never smiled a lot, but he always found a way to get to you. Gilbert Perreault, probably the greatest hockey player that I've ever played with, I've ever seen, as a matter of fact. He was so good, he didn't know how good he was. And I don't want you to be offended by what I'm going to say, but had Gilbert Perreault played for the Montreal Canadiens, you would have never heard of Guy Lafleur. Mm-hmm. That's how good he was. He just, he did things that I was baffled nights in and nights out watching him do things that I'd sit there and shake my head and say, how can you do something like this? He'd go, I don't know. I'll give you one night we're playing against Boston and we're coming down 2-on-1 on Bobby Orr, and I'm probably 10 feet behind just in case he drops the puck. He digs Bobby Orr and Bobby stumbles in his feet and falls down and we'll go in and score. And we get back to center ice and Bobby with his head down yelled at Gilbert. He goes, Bert, give me my jockstrap back. The purest goal scorer that I've seen. Inside the blue line, he was as good as Rocket Richard. Or you just enjoyed Rico's company, but when he came to play, he was all business. Away from the rink, he had... I said to him one day, I said, Rico, you should have never been a hockey player. You should have been a stand-up comedian. He was so good at what he did, and he surely missed in Buffalo. We played the Leafs that night, and Imlach allowed him to drive his car to Toronto. And he said to Tim, make sure you come right back, because we were playing Atlanta the next night. And 2 days before that, I had broken his jaw in practice with a shot. And Timmy was all wired up on medication, and coming back, I guess she had a couple of cocktails and just the back wheel of the car came off and killed himself. See, this was behind the net, and that was blue line. If you were shooting the puck and you'd yell at him, he'd know who you were by the color of your sweater. He had no idea who you were. He was as blind as a bat. And he drove like a maniac. Jim Schoenfeld, different guy. Good team man. Worked hard all the time. Came to Buffalo with very little talent. Terrible skater, but persevered to skating drills and power skating, and that made himself a half decent hockey player. Danny's different. Danny's a very good friend of mine. We spent a lot of time together. Danny was like Rico. He was a goal scorer. He couldn't carry the puck from here to the wall, but you give him the puck and you could shoot him.
What would you say about Rene Robert?
Don't take him on your team. Oh, what can you say about him? I love the game. From the time I was 5 years old, I grew up in a family of 11 kids. My dream was to be a hockey player. And you can dream as much as you want. You got to be lucky, you got to be good, and a lot of things have to go your way in order to make it. And I was fortunate, lucky enough that I made it. Otherwise, I don't know what I would have done.
The French Connection. Did I read someplace that you guys actually trademarked that name?
I did.
How did you do
that? Well, I mean, it's no hidden secret that Larry Quinn and I had are falling out years ago. But I decided at that time that I would trademark the French Connection so he wouldn't use it. And I offered Rico and Gilbert a piece of the action, and they chose not to, so I kept it to myself. But every time we did something, I always split the profit in three equal shares. I never took more than they did.
Around it comes to Rick Martin, up ahead for Perreault. Perreault coming to center.
Back then, the old building, when it's, especially in the finals, it was like 90 degrees outside in late May. They have kids skating around with sheets, and this is on national television. Skating around with sheets, trying to get rid of the fog. But it is very, very difficult to play hockey in the fog because you can't breathe. You want to know about the goal?
Yeah, I just thought I'd segue into that. I thought you'd talk about it.
If I told you I picked the corner, you wouldn't believe me. You know, I could try that a million times over. When things are meant to happen, it happens. And you know what? I had this much room. If I had that, and I just aimed there, and I just happened to hit that spot. I could try that a million times over, probably never hit it. It was just meant to be that day. Pure luck.
To center, dumps it off the boards in the corner. Robert going after it, he scores! Rene Robert! And the Sabres win it again in overtime! Off the boards in the corner, Robert pounded it between the legs of Bernie Perrot! And the Buffalo Sabres are right back in the Stanley Cup Final.
Ladies and gentlemen, Rene Robert, this is outstanding. Thank you so much.
Thank you.